有夠鐘。
Right, we've reached the appointed hour. This is a meeting of the Commerce Industry Panel. Item number one, information papers issued since last meeting. The administration has provided the following papers. Information paper on financial position of the Applied Research Fund for the period from 1st December 2014 to 28th February 2015. Paper CB1 1041 / 141501. And also Legislative Council briefs on United Nations Sanctions Yemen Regulation 2015, United Nations Sanctions Libya Regulation 2011, Yemen Regulation 2015, and United Nations Sanctions Côte d'Ivoire Regulation 2015, CITB CR75/59/9, CITB CR95/53/1, and CITB CR136/53/1. Item 2, date of next meeting, items for discussion. Date of next meeting, 17 from November to 30 p.m. It's a Tuesday. Two items for discussion, latest development of testing and certification industry. Item 1 on the list of outstanding items. And the second one is progress of negotiations under the WTO and on other plurilateral trade agreements. Item 2 on the list. Any questions? If not, then we move on to agenda item number 3. And that is a report on the work of the overseas Hong Kong ETOs and offices of the SARG in mainland and Taiwan in 2014-15. First of all, I will, if I may, invite the permanent secretaries of the Commerce and Economic Development Bureau and also the CMAB and also the trade representatives for attending our meeting. May I welcome all of you home for attending our meeting. Mr. Philip Yong, will you have some opening remarks? Thank you, Chairman. In this legislative session, this is the first time we attend a meeting of the panel on commerce and industry, and I look forward to closer cooperation with you all. Today we have the heads of the ETOs and also our heads of representatives in Taiwan and Beijing to report to you. This is an important task. They are here to report to you the important aspects of their work and listen to your advice and answer your questions. We've already provided the papers highlighting the work of various offices since the last report. The international economic circumstances are still uncertain, and there are also geopolitical factors affecting the world. Our colleagues in the ETOs are very closely monitoring the factors that may affect Hong Kong's economic and trade interests. And they have also been promoting our interests overseas, both in terms of trades and investments. They also organize cultural activities to promote Hong Kong overseas. The focus of world economics has moved to Asia, and Hong Kong is Asia's world city. And we plan that in 2016, we'll add a new ETO in Jakarta, Indonesia, so as to further expand our cooperation with the ASEAN, so as to enhance our competitiveness in Asia. We will continue to organize publicity, promotion, and cultural activities to promote Hong Kong's advantages and cultural heritage. We will so that our so that Hong Kong will continue to become the super connector between the mainland and the other countries, and Hong Kong will also become a cultural hub to attract people to come to visit Hong Kong. With your permission, Mr. Chairman, I'll invite my colleagues to update you on the relevant areas. I will invite those from Washington, Brussels, Beijing, Shanghai, and Tokyo to Singapore and Tokyo to report to you. Yes, Mr. Clement Leung from Washington. Well, Chairman, I will highlight the American ETOs in the United States with three offices: Washington, New York, and San Francisco. Our main task is to promote Hong Kong's trade and economic interests in the United States, and there are three major areas of work. First, we pay close attention to the political and economic trend in the United States and report on the acts and laws, policies and measures that affect our business there. We also update them on the latest, those in the United States, the latest economic and situation in Hong Kong. We also promote bilateral trade and promote bilateral investments. And the third area is to promote cultural, art, sports, exchanges. On the economic front, the trade relationship between Hong Kong and mainland is relatively stable. The United States is the second trade partner of Hong Kong, and Hong Kong is the 10th export market of the United States. Hong Kong has maintained an open economy. We also have worked a lot on protecting IP. We have no great trade disputes with the United States. The bilateral trade and economic relationship has been stable. But we need to pay attention to three areas. First, the interest rate trend of the United States. In the second quarter of this year, the growth of the United States economy reached 3.9%, higher than general expectation. Increase in number of jobs was less than expected, benefited by decline in commodity and energy prices. Inflation was not able to approach the 2% target set by the Fed. Together with uncertainties in the external economic situation, the Fed, at its meeting in September, decided to maintain the current interest rates. If the United States continue to enjoy mild economic growth, economic data of the United States indicated that they might increase interest at the end of this year, early next year. Since Hong Kong dollar is pegged to the US dollar, the timetable for normalization of interest rates in the United States should be something we need to pay special attention. As for the financial situation of the federal government, the Democrats and the representatives have the representatives have different views concerning the economy, and therefore the budget is an uncertainty, and there may be the chance of suspension of the operation of the federal government before the 3rd of November. The Congress will have to approve the national debt limit. Otherwise, there will be a default. Under such circumstances, there may be fluctuations, rather big fluctuations, in the national market. And Hong Kong, being a financial center, will also be affected. And then the third is the TPP. The Trans-Pacific Partnership. The United States, together with 11 countries in Asia-Pacific region, signed a trade agreement. In early October, the 12 TPP members reached a free trade agreement. Up till now, we have yet to see the text of the agreement. When the text is disclosed, we will report to Hong Kong immediately. Within the United States, with regard to the TPP, the views are widely divided. Democrats adopts a rather opposing attitude, and whether it can be passed by the Congress is still a question, and we are watching the matter very closely. Another major task is investment promotion. Our office visited 500 enterprises and companies in the United States, and more than 40 companies started their business in Hong Kong, expand the business in Hong Kong. As for promoting exchanges, we organize or co-organize film festivals in 9 cities to promote creative industry in Hong Kong. And we introduce new directors and films from Hong Kong to the United States. In 5 major cities of the United States, we organize Dragon Boat Festival to promote the active side of Hong Kong. And we also step up liaison with students, schools, companies, and groups, local groups. We also support Hong Kong groups performing in the United States so that more people in the United States understand the various aspects of our cultural life. Now, the 2016 is election year. They will elect a new president. Apart from president, there will also be a re-election of the Congress, including the House and also the Senate. 1/3 of the Senate will be re-elected. We'll have to participate in the election. Now they are in the primaries. We're considering the political platforms of the leading candidates. And if need be, we will consider the economic implications, and we'll adjust our PR policy. Thank you, Chairman. All right. Mr. Leung is the commissioner for Economic and Trade Affairs in the United States. I will now invite Ms. Shelley Lam, Special Representative to the EU. Well, I'll report to members the work of our 3 offices. They are in Brussels, London, and Berlin. First, in Europe, with regard to their latest economic situation with the depreciation of the euro, and also the economic measures by the European Union, such as the European Investment Programme involving 315 billion euros. Under such policies, there are signs of economic recovery. In the second quarter of 2015, the economic growth of 1.6%, unemployment rate latest for the whole of Europe was 9.5%. Since 2011, this was a new low. As for the European debt crisis, the Greek debt crisis in Greece and European Union agreed on a program, so there is some relief. As for economic and trade relationship with the European Union and the European countries, the European Union is the second largest trade partner after the mainland. We are watching very closely the policies in Europe which will affect Hong Kong.
There are a couple of examples here. Earlier on, for instance, Hong Kong had been listed erroneously as non-cooperative tax jurisdictions. This is a wrongful inclusion of Hong Kong on this list because we certainly do not live up to the criteria for inclusion into the list. And now they have made amendments, so Hong Kong does not appear on the list any longer. And we have been proactively assisting promoting the signing of avoidance of double taxation, which is a comprehensive agreement that Hong Kong and the European countries have signed so that companies do not need to be paying tax in both areas. That is Hong Kong and those European countries. The Hong Kong-Italy agreement was concluded in August of this year, and we are continuing with our negotiations with the other countries in Europe. And in the past year, we have received a number of senior officials from the Hong Kong SAR in visiting Europe. We have organized a number of seminars, luncheons, in order to promote the strong points of Hong Kong. Now, the three officers had also organized a number of activities, one of which would be to attract more talents coming to Hong Kong. And we have launched the enhanced talent admission schemes in May of 2015 to attract, in particular, the second generation of Hong Kong people who have emigrated to Europe, and attracting them to come back to Hong Kong to live and work. And we have Hong Kong Immigration Department officers explaining about this in various cities in Europe. And also, we have conducted a number of activities promoting art groups and performing groups and music groups from Hong Kong. And for cultural cooperation, in May of this year, on the Chief Secretary's visit to Ireland, we have taken the opportunity to enter into an MOU with Ireland. And also in the film festival for Hong Kong, we have featured kung fu movies, and we believe that that will attract the European viewers to Hong Kong, and also the variety of Hong Kong films through the kung fu aperture. And also for the students of Hong Kong, we have a academic program whereby we organized for 19 secondary schools in Hong Kong and 12 from Europe, and the students from these secondary schools had been exchanging views on green living and other pertinent topics. Now, as for investment promotion, the three officers have been to visit a number of companies. Over 100 companies have come to Hong Kong to set up offices. And looking ahead, we will, of course, strengthen our work. And in particular, in view of the One Belt, One Road policy of China, and Europe is definitely within that sphere of the One Belt, One Road. Basically, we will be promoting Hong Kong's role as the super connector in that midst. Yes, I would like to ask Ms. Yang to speak next. Yes. This is the, first of all, I would like to report on the Geneva. The work in Geneva and the past year, and the ETO in Geneva basically is to represent Hong Kong, China in the three trade organizations, the WTO, and also the Legal Support Office, and also the Paris Economic Cooperation Organization. And of the three, what takes most of our time would be the WTO. In terms of WTO-related work, the main task on hand is to prepare for the December meetings of the ministers. There is special meaning in the December meeting of the ministers because this is the 20th anniversary of the WTO, and also it is the first meeting to be held in Africa, and in particular, it is to be held in Nairobi, in Kenya, of Africa. And so there are expectations, in particular from the African countries, for this meeting. They feel that they would be able to see certain progress coming out from this meeting. This is a multilateral kind of work. So our work basically is focused on multilateral negotiations on trade. This is still the Doha round of negotiations. In fact, it's been going on for a year. The objectives are set very high, and it is very difficult to approach because of its multilateral nature. And the watchword is in development, and specifically, what does it mean? But basically, in the 161 members of the WTO, for developing countries or non-developed countries, how do we help them open up their markets and to enhance their commercial environment, provide support in terms of technology, skills, and other areas so that they can, as soon as possible, access the international commercial world. As mentioned earlier, the objectives or the standards are set very high, and it being multilateral, the negotiations are highly complex, and there are areas such as agriculture. How do we cut the subsidies for agriculture and also in industry, service industry? How do we improve on the access of the markets? All these have not reached consensus yet. Now, from mid-October to mid-December, in these short few weeks to the run-up to the ministerial meeting, this round of Doha negotiations, would there be any definite results? Should we approach the agenda in a way that we can be at least be able to attain certain specific, valuable, and conclusions that we can reach consensus on? So this is something that we are working flat out on in the next period of time. Now, the negotiations, how will the negotiations continue to proceed? Will the model be changed? Or should we review in the agenda whether there are priorities that we should devote our attention to before we do others? So these are very important topics to consider. From now to the run-up to the ministerial meeting, and we would definitely want to have consensus at the meeting. And apart from that, we are also drafting the joint declaration to be made public or promulgated at the ministerial meeting. Also, we have been participating very actively in multilateral negotiations. This is not 161 members of the organization. It would usually be a dozen or 20 organizations coming together where they have common interests, common objectives. They would come together for negotiations amongst themselves. There are three of these altogether. We are participating in all of them. First of all, the PISA, the Trade and Services Agreement. And basically, this is about liberalization in services trade. And it aims to improve market access and develop new and enhanced disciplines for a wide range of service sectors. And then there is also the communications information technology agreement. And this is basically to increase additional products in the area of information technology. And further, there is the environmental friendly agreement, and this is about lowering or cutting the tariffs of hundreds of environmental products. So all three of these negotiations are progressing satisfactorily, and basically the market access and the standards and the regulations are being negotiated for the trade in services. As for information technology agreement, we are discussing the timetable for slashing of tariffs. As for environmental products, because we had been proceeding slowly, we are still discussing some of the issues surrounding the environment. While we promote on trade, the products indeed promote environmental protection. Even though not all members of the organization participate in these negotiations, but they welcome new members. That is to say, these are not closed-ended organizations where the members have the same aspirations and conditions and also are willing to join, then they are welcome to join. For example, Mauritius had joined the TISA only recently. As for the ITA and also the environmental products tariffs slashing, when the negotiations are settled and finalized, the benefits will be made available to all members concerned, because we do want to share the results of the negotiations with all members in the organization. Now, if I can just touch on some of the developments since my last report. November of last year, Hong Kong had reviewed the trade policy for Hong Kong. This is done once every 4 years, and basically the trade policy of Hong Kong SAR would be written up and given to the other members of the organization for opinions. Basically, we have received very good reviews. We have been lauded for our openness, for our multilateral trade support, and therefore it had been invariably positive. And end of last year, we have also become the first member in the organization to have signed up on the trade facilitation. And this is, even though it had already been set at the last round of the Ministerial Council meeting, however, this had to accumulate a number of signatories, that is to 108 signatories, that is 2/3 of the of the members would have signed before it can come to pass. And right now, 51 had signed, and Hong Kong had been the first to submit its signature. And we are working on the other members. Now, middle of this year, we were within the first batch of members to have come up with a circulation of and notification of trade, service trade, and that is allowing these non-developed countries, allowing them better market access, how we are able to provide that information to them so that they are able to access the service trade market more easily. And also in Paris, there was the Ministerial Council meeting, and the Secretary had led the Hong Kong delegation, and we have also participated in the informal ministerial meeting. We have been actively participating, and we have some results to show as well. Next, Ms. Fu.
Yes, thank you, Chairman. I will highlight our report. Our main function is to strengthen Hong Kong SLG's liaison with the ministries of the CPG, and we also serve to strengthen relationship of 10 provinces and municipalities on autonomous regions. They cover Beijing, Tianjin, Hebei, Liaoning, Jilin, Heilongjiang, in the Mongolia, Xinjiang, Ningxia, and Jiangsu. Under the BJO, we have the Liaoning Representative Office, which operated starting from last year, and there was a formal opening in April. The office is in Shenyang of Liaoning. It is to strengthen our liaison with northeastern China. This is to improve G2G work. It will promote our trade and economic relations with the three northeastern provinces and also assist Hong Kong people and Hong Kong enterprises in the mainland. The BGO is paying attention to mainland trade laws and regulations and policies. It covers very wide areas, including taxation, social security, labor relation, import-export of goods. This covers the nationwide policies and rules, and also the rules and regulations in the provinces and municipalities where we work. We pay attention to the various notices and information in relation to trade and services. There are also themed seminars and meetings. In May, in Tianjin, Free Trade Zone, after the economic zone was set up, special economic zone was set up, we organized a seminar inviting representatives of the Tianjin municipal government to explain their high purchase, trade facilitation, quarantine inspection, financial innovation, and other areas. They brief the Hong Kong entrepreneurs on these areas. The BJO and the SVJ, together with the International Trade Promotion Association of China, organized a dispute resolution seminar with the going out of mainland enterprises with One Road, One Belt. More enterprises in the mainland will cut deals with other companies overseas. They are briefed on how Hong Kong can help them in dispute resolution. These activities have won the support of Hong Kong enterprises and mainland enterprises. Apart from liaising with Hong Kong businessmen who are in China, in the mainland, we also liaise with students who are Hong Kong students who are studying in the mainland. In the beginning of this academic year, we've organized an orientation meeting with the students. We organize career talks. We invite those who work in the mainland to share the experience of Hong Kong students who are studying in the mainland. Now, this is to provide a platform to enable the Hong Kong students know each other and build up their network. We also liaise with three major commerce associations in the mainland and in order to provide internship to Hong Kong students who are studying in the mainland. As for the promotion of films, of cultural affairs and film in particular, we have two themed exhibitions. One themed exhibition is this. Now, in participating in the trade fairs, we bring along the theme of innovative design to tell the Hong Kong story. Another theme exhibition is working with a famous brand and this is supported by Great Hong Kong. When we organize the events in Beijing, we organize that with the Hong Kong Association of Manufacturers, there is an expo in Tianjin, and that exhibition is very successful. We brought along a famous designer we adopt an innovative approach to contact the people there. We attracted about 300,000 citizens. And the same series of exhibitions were also brought to Beijing and Shenyang. And the exhibition in Shenyang was just completed last week. We are promoting Hong Kong's soft power through these cultural exchanges, and will continue to go along this theme. Next speaker. Next, I would like to invite our representative at of Shanghai ETO to speak, Victoria Tang. Chairman, our main function is to promote is to enhance liaison and communication between the SALG and the main authorities in municipality of Shanghai, promote Hong Kong, enhance economic and trade cooperation between Hong Kong and the region, and provide appropriate information assistance to Hong Kong enterprises and residents operating, working, and living in the region. The SHGTO has been paying close attention to the policies that may affect Hong Kong, say, for example, the economic free trade zone in Shanghai, the One Belt, One Road policy, and also other issues of common concern to Hong Kong entrepreneurs and enterprises. We organize theme seminars. We also release suitable appropriate information immediately to Hong Kong entrepreneurs so that they can take the opportunity, make use of opportunities available in Eastern China. We issue 39 issues of newsletters. We also report in a timely manner the latest economic policy changes in laws and regulations and rules. Since the setting up of the Shanghai Free Trade Zone, more than 170 Hong Kong enterprises have set up in the region, and accounting for 45% of the overseas firms set up in the zone. There is also the third round of cooperation meeting. The CE, SALG, and the Shanghai Mayor jointly chair the meeting. This is Shanghai Hong Kong Cooperation Summit. 27 points of agreements have been reached, and 3 agreements have been signed in terms of financial services and trade and interchange of civil servants, exchange of civil servants among civil servants. There is a multi-level of exchange between Hong Kong and Shanghai, and we also closely working with the students in the area we serve. We liaise with the students, Hong Kong students who are studying in those areas. And this year we organize 2 seminars in respect of seeking jobs in the area. We help the students to learn the interview techniques and understand the market demand in the area. In Shanghai, Zhejiang, and Jiangsu, we organize meetings with the university students there so that we have a better understanding of the Hong Kong students who are studying in this area, or in these areas, to grasp the opportunity. In Eastern China, the SHEOT set up its Shandong Liaison Office. In Jinan, it was set up in Jinan. The liaison office endeavors to promote the economic, cultural, and trade relation and cooperation between Shandong and Hong Kong, and it will also assist Shandong enterprises making use of Hong Kong as a platform to go out to the world. We also have meetings with Hong Kong residents and also Hong Kong enterprises in Shandong to provide better support. As for promoting investment, the SHGTO also promotes Hong Kong as a platform for mainland enterprises to go out to the world and also encourage them to make Hong Kong as a test base for investment and trade. We organized 32 visits and we have brought about 21 successful cases. We'll continue to promote cooperation between the SALG and the various departments and offices of the mainland. Hong Kong will link China to the world and the world to China. Hong Kong plays the role of a super connector and promote pluralistic developments. Next is the ETO representative of Singapore, Mr. Bruno Luk. Our ETO is responsible for promoting Hong Kong's multilateral trade, economic and cultural relationship between Hong Kong and the ASEAN countries. There are 10 of them. The ASEAN has become the second biggest trade partner of the ASEAN from 2010 to 2014. Trade volumes increased by 6% annually on average. In 2014, $161 billion. The cost of the ASEAN countries is rather low. Hong Kong is investing in the ASEAN countries, and there has been continuous growth. The Singapore ETO has arranged the CE and seven major principal officials to visit the ASEAN countries on 8 occasions. We also take the opportunity. We also took the opportunity to organize dinners and luncheons to promote Hong Kong among the ASEAN countries and promote Hong Kong's advantages. We also publicize Hong Kong as a major offshore renminbi center, Hong Kong's role as a super connector between mainland and the ASEAN countries. In April 2015, at the 12th summit meeting of the ASEAN leaders, the CE had the opportunity to speak, and we also arranged bilateral meeting with 6 ASEAN leaders on promoting bilateral economic, trade, and cultural relations. The CSOA visited Brunei, and we arranged a ministerial meeting with the ministers of Brunei, and also she had the opportunity to update the various ministers on the opportunities offered by the One Belt, One Road. We continue to support the negotiation, free trade negotiation with the ASEAN. The fourth round of meeting was organized in July 2015 in Singapore. Next year, we hope that the negotiation can be completed. After the signing of the FTA, it will certainly promote a closer economic partner relationship with the region. In September this year, the CE visited Indonesia. We arranged a meeting between him and the President and Vice President of Indonesia. The SJ also visited Indonesia to promote Hong Kong's role as a dispute resolution center. As for cultural exchange, the Singapore ETO promotes cultural exchange with the ASEAN. We sponsored many groups visiting ASEAN countries and conducted performances. From March to July, we invited the representatives of Hong Kong Arts Festival to Singapore. We also sponsored the Fringe Club to visit Singapore in July to participate in the Spotlight Hong Kong in Singapore. This is after the Spotlight Hong Kong in Penang. This is a series of such activities. 50 young artists, creative entrepreneurs had the opportunity to conduct exchanges with their counterparts, some 50 counterparts in Singapore. And the youth orchestra will also have a chance to perform. As for the internship, ASEAN internship for university students Hong Kong scheme, we organized it for 2 years in a row.
200位, 分別是,
and there were some 200 interns placed in 8 ASEAN countries in the coming from the universities, and they were successfully placed around the ASEAN countries. And this is very good in allowing the students with an exposure to the very colorful and varied culture and life in the ASEAN countries. And during this reporting period, we have also visited a number of ASEAN companies, and also we have outreached proactively to key interlocutors in the region, including Hong Kong community, government officials, media, think tanks, etc., to keep them abreast of the latest developments and situation in Hong Kong. The ETO also hosted two gatherings in May of this year to meet with a total of some 70 Hong Kongers to brief them on the enhanced talent admission schemes and the new admission scheme for second generation of Chinese Hong Kong permanent residents. For investment promotion, we have met with more than 130 ASEAN companies and assisted 26 of them in establishing their business in Hong Kong during the same period. And we have organized 15 investment promotion visits to Singapore and promoting Hong Kong and to the ASEAN countries. And also we have signed the organized joint promotion seminar with a number of areas, and we have also we will continue to promote Hong Kong's position among the ASEAN countries. Thank you very much. The last report is to be made by Ms. Wong from the Tokyo office. Ms. Sally Wong, please. Yes, the Tokyo office is responsible for promoting a number of areas, and mainly the understanding and close economic and trade ties, culture and tourism exchange with Japan and the Republic of Korea. First of all, on the Japan. Now, since the consumer tax had been raised in Japan to 8% from 5%, and also the economic indices have been volatile. No one had been very clear whether the Japanese economy is on the right track for good, and also one could not still tell whether the economic reforms are putting the country's economy on the right route. Also, the three arrows of Abenomics, and in a number of areas, including releasing female workers with the objective of promoting the nominal GDP to increase that to 6 trillion yen from 4 trillion plus yen. And given that, the weakening of the yen, there had been a lot of impetus to the tourism industry. Tourists going into Japan had increased by 50% in the reporting year, and tourists from Hong Kong had also increased by some 70% to Japan. And for the first half, it was 1 million Hong Kong tourists going to Japan. Korea is the sixth largest trading partner of Hong Kong. And in June of last year, the CE visited Korea. And the CE had met with the premier of the Korean Republic and also met with a number of leaders in the innovative and commercial field. And also there had been luncheons in which the CE had addressed the commercial community, and also the head of trade and commerce had also signed an MOU for trade on his trip to the Korean Republic. Because of the outbreak of Middle East respiratory syndrome MERS in Korea, it had affected the business and tourism exchanges between Hong Kong and Korea, but since no more new cases were found, the red OTA, outbound travel alert, was removed in August, and we have resumed our regular promotion liaison work in Korea. Now, as for the Tokyo ETO, we continue to liaise with the media, the leaders, opinion leaders, and also various communities within Japan. Apart from economics and trade, we continue to promote the cultural exchange activities between Hong Kong and Japan. Apart from the CE having visited Korea, we have also received a number of officials visiting Japan, and in January of this year, there was a visit from a senior official to promote the trade in to promote trade. And also in May of this year, there had been a visit to Korea to especially to promote the area of technology cooperation. And also in March of this year, the chair of the LegCo had also visited Japan. And we continue to raise the profile of Hong Kong in a number of cities in Japan, including Sapporo, Nagoya, Gifu, Shizuoka, etc., and in Sendai, and to meet potential clients and to brief the local Japan External Trade Organization concerning the latest development environment in Hong Kong. And also we have met with a number of leaders in the prefectural government and city government and regional banks as well. And at the same time, we have done a number of public relations activities. In Tokyo, we have organized a Hong Kong in miniature exhibition, attracting some 40,000 visitors, and also the 2014-15 Hong Kong Cup All Japan University Student Ambassadors English Program. We had sponsored students in visiting Hong Kong to visit public institutions, and also a 10-day exchange program at the Chinese University of Hong Kong. And in February of this year, we had organized a very large-scale special focus on Hong Kong at the Osaka Asia Film Festival, featuring Hong Kong films. And also the Asian Youth Orchestra's performance in Tokyo, Osaka, was sponsored by us as well. And also in the City Contemporary Dance Company's performance in August of this year at the Niigata International Dance Festival was also sponsored by us. And also for the Busan Film Festival, we had also organized a Hong Kong night cocktails to promote our films. And in various newspapers this year, we have taken out full-page supplement, including the Japan News, a major English language newspaper, in January of this year. And there were two meetings in Osaka and two in Tokyo. Using these opportunities, we promoted the second generation Hong Kong permanent residence scheme. and we continue to promote Hong Kong through various activities, promoting the bilateral relationship between Hong Kong and Japan and Hong Kong and Korea. We will, through major and large-scale activities jointly organized by the TDC, Invest Hong Kong, etc., to extend our interface and also the efficacy of our activities, and also leveraging on the visits of Hong Kong delegations and officials, we will continue to extend and build relationship with the various communities. Yes, Q&A time, members. Before you do that, let me remind you, Hong Kong and Taiwan trade relationship or issues can be discussed in the next agenda item. So for following up on Hong Kong-Taiwan issues, please leave those questions to the next agenda item. Now, we have six members who had indicated interest to speak. Any more? There being none, I will extend this session a bit longer, 5 minutes each. Leung Kuan Yin, read out the names, if you will. Leung Kuan Yin, Lam Dai Wei, Lo Wei Kwok, Chiang Lai Wan, Lam Kim Fong, Chung Kwok Phan. Mr. Leung, please. Thank you, Mr. Chair. First of all, I would like to welcome you all back, heads of the ETOs, and to thank you for your presentations just now. Now, we've been talking about the Doha round of negotiations. It's been going on for over 10 years, and there are now a number of schemes or regional schemes. Now, a few weeks ago, the TPP seemed to have come onto stream in a hurry. And I was told that we don't even have the text of the agreement yet. Now, for the garment industry, we are in the forefront, or we're bearing the brunt of the effects. Now, I would like to ask, for these signatories in the TPP, what is their stage of preparedness? Is it possible for this to be implemented in a short period of time? Now, Malaysia would be one of the beneficiaries, and ASEAN ETO perhaps can perhaps throw some light as to what this will mean, because these would be potential competitors of ours. Thank you very much for the question, Mr. Leung. Perhaps I should respond, and then I will have Mr. Leung give you the details. Concerning the TPP, we are fully in support of free trade progress, and we welcome any regional agreement that promotes free trade. For TPP, there are a number of our major trading partners. We will continue to be alert to the developments of the TPP. Mr. Leung, please. Yes. We have been monitoring very closely the discussions on TPP. But of course, the negotiations among the signatories are confidential, but we would be able to pick up some information here and there. And personally, I would see that this is about tariffs and concessions and also market access. For the manufacturers of Hong Kong, where we are concerned, in fact, a lot of the content is not directly relevant to us. It's very much agricultural, auto parts, but of course, we would be more alert to concessions concerning garment, the garment industry. And there are investments of Hong Kong businessmen in Vietnam, etc. Now, for the garment industry, for instance, the rules of origin, the requirement is more stringent. There is a yarn forward rule, that is starting from yarn, the manufacturing, before it can qualify for a concession. So within these countries, if the fabric is done or manufactured within this region, then there can be certain concessions. As for trade investment regulations, it is also pertinent as well, and they're very wide-ranging. Where there are controversies, how are they to be resolved? And labor issues, environment requirement issues, these are all discussed. But it seems that the discussions are still ongoing. We do not have the text or the specifications yet. I'm sure when the texts are indeed available, our trade officers will make some comparison. Right now, this is all quite hearsay. As for the preparedness of the countries, now once the agreement had been signed, there will have to be local internal procedures which have to be run through. Some will actually require the local parliament to sanction them. And within some of the parliaments, there are controversies as well.
And there is also a general election in Canada. There are quite a lot of certain uncertainties. Experts say that it's very unlikely that the agreement will be approved by the parliaments within a short period of time. The internal procedures will only be completed after the general election in the United States. Next, Mr. Lam Tai Fai, followed by Mr. Lo Wai Kwok. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to thank the ETO heads for updating us on their work in 2014-15 so that we have a better understanding of the situation in other parts of the world. Hong Kong is a world-class city. Hong Kong is the first country. Hong Kong is the first city which operates under one country, two systems. Whether the countries are advanced or are developing, our trade partners are paying close attention to Hong Kong's situation, in particular the economic situation and political situation. Mr. Clement Leung, the commissioner, said that the EDOs from time to time updated the various countries on Hong Kong's economic and economic development. In 2014-15, there were two major incidents. One, Occupy Central. 28th of September lasted for 75 days. The world was paying attention to that. The world paid attention to that. Mr. Leung, the commissioner or the representatives to the European Union, with regard to this, and also other heads of the EDOs, how did you interpret this, and how did you respond to the questions in relation to Occupy Central movement. The other is the political reform. Many countries were concerned about the political reform package in Hong Kong. Now, there was the council vetoed that with 28 votes against 8. Different countries had different interpretations and views towards the political reform. When you updated them on our political reform, how did you explain that to them? Why it was a failure, why it was rejected with a wide margin. They're related to economic issues. Well, I will say a few words as opening remarks, and then I will then invite Ms. Lam, the European Union Special Representative, to speak. One of the major tasks of EDO is to work through the networks we have built and speak to the various sectors of the overseas community, including those in the political field or in the financial sector. Now please focus on Occupy movement. I will invite the representatives to speak on individual issues. Mr. Clement Leung. Mr. Clement Leung. Yes, thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Lam, for the question. With regard to Occupy movement and political reform, generally speaking, the people over there learned about this through the media. Our impression was that the report by the media might not be comprehensive. With regard to certain matters, they had a certain impression. Our duty with regard to these two matters was to more comprehensively reflect the current situation in Hong Kong. What we said, or what we explained, was not very different from the statements made by our officials in this council. But we need to, we had to explain the basics, say the parliamentarians, the think tanks, the academics might not have a thorough understanding of the several steps requirement under the basic law or the basic law or the relationship between the Legislative Council and the NPCSC or the CPG. We explain these relationships. As for the report by the Occupy on the Occupy movement, the report by the media may not be too thorough. The media, overseas media, may just sold some snapshots, and they might saw people might see confusion. There were clashes. Upon the whole, the economic and investment environment was stable. Who's next? Ms. Lam. Well, if I might add, our situation was similar to that described by Mr. Leung. As said by Mr. Leung, we explained to the Europeans the requirement of the basic law, the decision of the NPCSC. As for the Occupy movement, we explained that it, on the whole, didn't have much impact on our economy. The European Union, every year, publishes a report on Hong Kong situation. In the May report, they again showed that one country, two systems was operating well in Hong Kong and continued to support Hong Kong under the framework of one country, two systems. Mr. Loe Kwok. Thank you, Chairman. The One Belt, One Road promoted by our country has attracted attention in the international community, and many countries have responded positively and have lent their support to this. Now, the representatives have mentioned that, and they have also mentioned Hong Kong's role as a super connector. Overseas promotion, of course, is very important, but internal promotion is also equally important, and that is, we should specify the business opportunities that will be brought about by the One Belt, One Road among our professionals and entrepreneurs, and also they should be informed of the opportunities available. So, what are your plans in respect of One Belt, One Road, both domestically and internationally? The One Belt, One Road, of course, is very important to our future economic growth. Hong Kong has been actively exploring the road that is available to us under One Belt, One Road. As for working that with the Chambers of Commerce and also various trades and industries, different Chambers of Commerce organize seminars and discussion groups, and we were also involved in those discussions. And we will continue to participate in these activities, or such activities. Later, the administration and other public bodies will organize seminars on a larger scale so that all of you will have better understanding of the One Belt, One Road. We also step up liaison with the countries within the One Belt, One Road zone or zones. Indonesia is a very important marine Silk Road country. Next year, we will set up our ETO in Jakarta. And that will also step up our relationship with the ASEAN countries. As for the free trade agreements, avoidance of double taxation agreements, they are also important. And our counterparts, many of them are within the One Belt, One Road zone. And such agreements will provide an advantage to our investors who are looking for opportunities in One Road, One Belt zones. Major principal officials will also lead delegations to visit the countries that fall within the One Belt, One Road zones. Trade delegations will also be organized to these countries. This will enable the trades and industries to have better understanding of the situation. The One Belt, One Road is still in an early stage, but through these activities, we'll have a better understanding and form a foundation for our policy and strategy. In the past month, I had two opportunities to meet with the officials of the Ministry of Commerce in the mainland. It's for specific measures, different ministries and commissions will be involved. Hong Kong has to be prepared. The business sector, the professional sector, should be fully informed. But at present, they are really their understanding is rather vague in terms of all these. Will there be a dedicated team to deal with that instead of just handling that with some of their time? The bureau involved in this is the CITB and also FSTB. We had opportunities to sit together to formulate our policy in response to One Belt, One Road, and having a dedicated team is also a good suggestion. With regard to coordination, we will consider the best way forward so that the work can be better done. Thank you very much for the advice. Next, Ms. Anne Chang, and then Mr. Jeffrey Lam.
Last year, there was the Occupy Central incident. This year, the economies of various countries were not so good, and there were also tourist incidents. This year, or rather yesterday, because of an incident outside a shop, a tourist died. With regard to these bits and pieces of news, would that adversely affect the business investment, overseas investment in Hong Kong? We heard how many countries have been helped, how many firms. In the past, we were told that how many firms were helped to start the business in Hong Kong. Not too many in this year's report. say 28 in one report, 28 companies were assisted, but in many reports nothing has been mentioned. Would that affect the investment, ODI, overseas investment in Hong Kong? With regard to attracting foreign investment, this is one of the tasks of our ETOs, and some reported on the achievements last year. In 2014, with regard to FDI, total FDI, Hong Kong ranked second in the world. It shows that we are still very effective in attracting FDI. Say in 2014-15, the total FDI was higher than those that in 2013-14. The trend is still going up for FDI. But we cannot lose our guard. Whether it is EDO, whether it is the ETO or it is the Invest Hong Kong, we cannot sit on our hands. The Invest Hong Kong will give you a detailed report in February.
And the Invest Hong Kong colleagues, when they come up, they'll be able to give you more information on investment trends in Hong Kong. Yes, I very appreciate your reports, and they are very comprehensive indeed. There's one thing which I find missing, though, and what is that? Because our ETOs are located all over the world, and they are basically our scouts, our sentries, in the sense that they are to pick up how the world sees us. And what are we to do given that? So my question is, will we include this in our reports in the future? That is, how Hong Kong should leverage on certain advantages, or how Hong Kong should use certain opportunities to further economic and trade ties? Well, of course, the ETOs will have to understand the situation in their respective regions or areas and how the developments would affect the economics and trade relationships with Hong Kong. And perhaps in the next round, we can perhaps provide more information for members' reference. Lam Kin Fong and then Chung Kwok Pan. Thank you, Mr. Chair. First of all, I would like to thank the officers for coming up and welcome back to Hong Kong. And please do not lock them up in the offices for meetings. There are a lot of major events in Hong Kong. The Wine Festival, for example, will be in full swing tomorrow. And this is time for them to visit those major events as well. And last year, because of Occupy Central, it had adversely affected the economy of Hong Kong. And there are certain groups which had been continuing with that trend, affecting the peace of and economy of Hong Kong, causing bodily harm to certain groups of visitors, etc. Now, in terms of welcoming guests to Hong Kong, how can we tell these people, these visitors to Hong Kong, that this is but the behavior of a very small group of Hong Kong people? As for One Belt, One Road, a number of you had touched on that. We have but the Singapore office in the ASEAN countries, and I was told, perhaps the CEO had said, that in Indonesia will also see another office, Hong Kong office, opened. And I can fully understand that it's very difficult to cover such a wide area. Now, for commercial opportunities, how can we, in the shortest time possible, be able to inform and notify the government officials or the business community in Hong Kong? And where should we establish the next office in Asia, ASEAN countries? I think this is something that we need to discuss, given One Belt, One Road in particular. So perhaps the officials can respond on these two points. Yes, Mr. Yeung. Well, first of all, on the activities of my colleagues and also our views on establishing a new office, perhaps Ms. Fu from the Beijing office can tell us about the publicity that we have targeted towards the mainland residents. And definitely, I can respond to your first question. Well, we're not going to lock them up in the offices for meetings. Their activities are varied. They're not only government-related. The wine festival, and on the Thursday or Friday, our colleagues have been invited to sample the wares and the wines and foods of the festival. And this helps them to be in tune with the latest developments of Hong Kong. This will definitely benefit our colleagues here. Now, as for the new trade office in Indonesia, where we need more staff, we will also have to come to the Finance Committee as well. But before that, we will come to this committee to seek your blessing. We will have to look at the Asian region, and also we have to look at the economic development as a whole in making that decision. But in the on the whole, we would want to extend our network, extend the coverage of our offices. Apart from staffing, our ETOs also leverage on the service of the local consultants in furthering their work. Perhaps I should ask Ms. Fu to talk about mainland residents' communications with you. Ms. Fu, in communicating with mainland residents, we need to make clarifications and explanations. For actions targeted against mainland tourists, it's definitely not what the majority of Hong Kong people would approve. And we need to clarify these and explain these actions to the mainland people. And there are policies and their policies such as one trip, 1 week to Hong Kong and other relevant policies, all these will need to be explained. How can we say that we are a welcoming city for visitors? Well, I think more of these wine and food events would be pertinent, and also apart from innovative and brand name promotions, for example, there was this handicraft creations with brand names, Hong Kong brand name promotions, which had attracted 300,000 participants. And we brought it also to Beijing and to Shantung as well. And through these activities, we are able to positively promote the image of Hong Kong as a welcoming city to tourists. I would like to follow up on TPP as well. According to my understanding, a few years ago, when the U.S. pushed TPP. The U.S. government had approached the Hong Kong SAR government, but at the time, unfortunately, the Hong Kong SAR government was not enthusiastic, and there it just fizzled out. And Hong Kong is now not a participant of TPP, and this is a loss on the part of Hong Kong. Clement is here today. And I am in contact with the trade office of the U.S. Consulate. In the second round, the question is, can Hong Kong actively participate in it? And the financial secretary lately had said that this is open. Yes, definitely. Government is something that Hong Kong has to look into. We cannot be overly reliant on a couple of industries. We should extend the trades and industries that we have. Agriculture, somebody just said agriculture is not that relevant, but why not agriculture for Hong Kong? Perhaps we should be more proactive in responding to the U.S. officials. Yes, Mr. Yong. Thank you, Mr. Chung, for the question. As mentioned just now, for anything that helps with free trade, we support because it is beneficial for Hong Kong. As for the TPP, the financial secretary had said that we hold an open attitude towards it. But basically, going forward, I think what is most important is for us to negotiate with the ASEAN countries concerning free trade agreement. And these bilateral agreements or negotiations, we will be putting a lot of efforts into. Mr. Lau? Mr. Leung? Thank you, Mr. Chung, for the question. Yes, the agreement is an open one in the sense that after this round of negotiations and the internal procedures of the different signatory countries have been completed, yes, there can be new members admitted. And there will be more specific enshrinement concerning the new entrants for economic systems or countries. What are some of the conditions for joining? But because we do not have the text, we do not know the criteria as yet. And when we liaise with trade representatives from other countries, we know that the priorities is to implement, first of all, to complete the text and to complete the negotiations, promulgate it, and then for the signatory countries to complete their procedures. For some of the countries, the procedures would be complex. For example, the U.S. Congress will need 90 days' notice with the texts appended, and then there will have to be discussions as to what internal domestic laws will be affected before the Congress can discuss and adopt. So there will have to be these procedures, and for the agreement to be in enforcement, we believe that that will take a certain period of time. And so we will look into possibilities of including new entrants into the agreement. And also, we will also be closely pay attention to the negotiations among the initial 12 would-be members. And then we will report these back to Hong Kong. Mr. Chan, I understand that there will have to be due procedures in the parliaments or congresses. But what I'm trying to say is that in the future, let us be proactive in our dialogue with the U.S. and also with other countries. Mr. Ma. Mr. Chair, in the reports from the various ETOs, all of them have mentioned that there had been exchanges and promotions for the arts and culture in these overseas countries and jurisdictions. Now, the government had not been doing that, but in the past 10 years or so, I have seen that happening finally, gradually. And in fact, I have gone one step further to say that we should put culture into the title of the or the name of the ETO, but the government had not been responding as yet. Now, for performing groups, it is there had been activities organized for them, but not for the visual arts. I have collected, well, I would say, complaints to a certain extent from the visual arts field.
With regard to important cultural activities, the overseas organizers contact the artists directly. They don't work through our ETOs, and also the local artists, Hong Kong artists, do not get support from the government, from the SALG. Now, for example, the National Art Exhibition. It's a very important art exhibition in the mainland, but the artists in Hong Kong received a very late notice from the organizer. It was organized in a remote city. When the artists arrived, our artists found that Macau formed a very comprehensive team. They had a lot of they brought along souvenirs, and the government SALG of Macau paid all the expenses. This is not complaint. In the SALG, how does it deal with cultural exchange? Say, for example, it may be a task of the HAB given. A task given by the HAB to the ETOs, or will the ETOs take the opportunity and actively liaise with the relevant counterparts in the government offices and departments in the mainland, and then seek opportunities for our artists, or you wait for the notice given to the artists, and then through the offices and departments of our country liaise with the HAB and then liaise with the ETO, and the HAB liaise with ETOs. For example, the National Art Exhibition I referred to, at a very late stage, there was direct invitation given to Hong Kong artists. And they were really caught unprepared. The Hong Kong artists were caught unprepared. It was quite messy, if I may say so. Yes, Mr. Ma. You're just repeating your question. Maybe you give some time to them to answer your question. I'll say a few words. Maybe I invite my two colleagues, those from London and Toronto, to explain how they sponsor cultural activities. The member referred to the National Arts Exhibition. We will try to find out what exactly it is and how what exactly it was and how was it organized and what the problem was. As for our ETO sponsoring cultural activities, by and large, it is an interaction. Other bureaus may refer the cases to us. Maybe the orchestra raised this proposal with us, or maybe the ETO organizes an activity, and it looks into cultural organizations which can participate in the event. The ETOs pay attention to the situation very closely. If there are activities that fit the events, the ETOs will actively pursue such arrangements. Maybe the representatives from Toronto and London can speak on this. Yes, let me answer the question briefly. The London office also participates in promotion of cultural exchanges. There are many channels. As said by Mr. Ma, through our daily contacts, we liaise with local art groups of famous organizers, and we know that these activities are of interest to Hong Kong artists who will do our part to do the liaison. We also liaise with Hong Kong performers in the city, and if they have activities or performances, we'll provide our support. Say, for example, the BFI in London. One Hong Kong film participated in the festival, and we organized a simple reception last Friday in support of the Hong Kong film. We adopt a multi-pronged approach. We liaise with local organizations, we liaise with local performers, and we'll continue to beef up our liaison in this area. Who else? Yes, Ms. Lau. Thank you for the question. Our Toronto ETO contacts local groups and make arrangements for Hong Kong artists to participate in exhibitions. A few months ago, we liaise with an international gallery of Vancouver to make arrangements to assist mainland artists and Hong Kong artists to show their works in the gallery. It was well received. We'll continue, as said by other members, we'll liaise with the local organizers to enable Hong Kong artists to show their works in major cities in Canada. They will have a chance to show their achievements. Next, Mr. Martin Liao. Thank you, Chairman. I want to ask a broader question, and I hope that Mr. Clement Leung and also Ms. Shelley Lam and Ms. Irene Young will answer the question. Now, the WTO is a platform for the removal of roadblocks of trade. In recent years, we've seen bilateral trade agreements and multilateral trade agreements. They have become exceptions under the WTO. It seems that the exceptions are more than the rule. I also want to ask a question in respect of the TPP. It has become a trade group with 20 countries, said the speaker. And there is also the transatlantic agreement, or the transatlantic trade group. Now, you will have better information because you're over there. Now, they set up trade groups or trade blocks, different trade blocks. Will this trend threaten the WTO? We'd like to answer the question. I suggest Ms. Young will answer the question first and see if other members other colleagues can supplement. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Liao, for the question. You're right in pointing out that among members of the WTO, there are many bilateral agreements and plurilateral agreements. Most important point is that these agreements cannot breach the WTO agreement. Secondly, whether these bilateral agreements or plurilateral agreements are building blocks for promoting multilateral trade. In my briefing, I have quoted some examples. For example, there are several plurilateral negotiations, for example, IT agreement, environmental product agreement, They are tariff reduction agreements. Once these agreements are finalized, not only those who sign the agreements are given tariff relief, the agreement or the benefits of the agreement will also be shared by members of the WTO who have not participated in the agreement. These are useful for removing trade barriers and promoting multilateral trade. Mr. Leung, if I may add, many economies have noticed the slow growth in the WTO negotiations, and therefore they organized their trade blocks. The U.S. organized the TPIP and also TPP, and we've seen free trade agreements in various regions, and Hong Kong also has its own free trade policies. Say in the mainland, we have reached CIPA, we've signed CIPA. Hong Kong will consider these arrangements and try to promote free trade with various groups. Well, I have not made any value judgment. I ask whether there will be such a trend, and if there is, then what's the use of the WTO? I cannot see the TPP or TPIP can help to remove trade barriers. They will have discrimination, big or small. My question is, would that become a trend? What is your view? If it is, then will that threaten the WTO? This is a complicated question. Ms. Young, please. If I may add, with regard to the bilateral trade agreements or multilateral trade or plurilateral trade agreements, they cannot replace the multilateral trade system. The multilateral trade system is a very effective system, so that a single agreement can be applicable to many members. And there are also special arrangements for developing countries and least developed countries, and the measures are to help them. Though there are plurilateral trade arrangements among different members in different regions, judging from the addresses made by members of the WTO, the support given to the WTO is very strong. The plurilateral agreements or bilateral agreements will not threaten the WTO. Mr. Lam Tai Fai is going to ask the second round. Please make good use of the time. We still have one more item on the agenda. My second question is similar to the first one, or is related to the first one. We are concerned about economic development of Hong Kong. If we need to have pluralistic development and balanced development, Hong Kong cannot rely on the domestic economy. Overseas investment, overseas orders, overseas tourists coming to Hong Kong are important. The Occupy movement and the failure of implementing political reform are matters of international concern. The political situation is closely related to our economy. According to the reference to the Basic Law, the decision of the NPCSC, they resort to these to explain the Occupy movement and also the political reform failure. This is your stance. I'm not going to make life difficult to you. But if these two events or incidents have deterred overseas investors, then in the long term and also in the short term, that will affect Hong Kong's economy. Your explanation of the Basic Law and the NPCSC's decision, and also the explanations of Hong Kong officials,
the effectiveness is rather ordinary, or the outcome is rather ordinary. I'm unable to assess whether their understanding is different. My concern is that after you have given your explanation, do they agree with you? Do the business groups overseas agree with you? Do the people where you work agree with you? And they will continue to invest in Hong Kong or come to Hong Kong as tourists. Now you say the report by the media is not was not comprehensive. Now you have a chance to explain to them face by face. What was their response? Did they believe you? Did they accept your explanation? And they continue to visit Hong Kong, spend in Hong Kong, invest in Hong Kong? Please answer a question. I'll say a few words and then Mr. Leung will supplement. Our colleagues, in explaining the two incidents, of course, will present the reasons, and also I would present the reasons, and also gave the and updated their interlocutors, and will also stress our advantages.
And in attracting foreign investments, we have certain advantages, and these will not be easily affected by individual incidents. Mr. Leung, please. Yes, Mr. Chair. Concerning political issues, political incidents, I understand that for U.S. citizens, in fact, they have a lot of information coming out from Hong Kong as well. Of course, they form their own opinions. As far as we are concerned, we explain how we understand the reality in Hong Kong is, but how much they really, how much we are able to get them on board, how much they buy our explanation, I really cannot tell. And as for the economic ties with Hong Kong, yes, when the incident was in the heat of it, Occupy Central, they were worried, and they had been thinking whether this will be a recurrent event in Hong Kong. But they saw that stability was restored in Hong Kong, and we do not see people thinking that our basic or fundamental advantages had been undermined. So your understanding is that Occupy Central had not adversely affected the desire or intention of foreigners in investing in Hong Kong, giving orders to Hong Kong manufacturers or coming to Hong Kong as tourists. Well, in answer to your question, I do not see any fundamental changes in that perception. Thank you very, very much for coming up to the LegCo to brief us. I think we still have another chance of meeting with you later on. Yes, do take a rest and then we'll meet again. Now, let us go to the next agenda item. And that is the Hong Kong-Taiwan relationship. Yes, we welcome Ms. Cheng in joining our meeting. No. Yes, we have already submitted a paper. Yes, Mr. Chair, perhaps I can very briefly go through the three areas of work in Taiwan. First of all, in trade promotion, in investment promotion, and in cultural promotion. It's been 4 years since the establishment of the office, and in the past 1 year, we have been working very closely with the different trade and industrial organizations and the trade office of Taiwan to build up the relationship, and we have been visiting the Hong Kong businessmen in Taiwan to enhance our closeness and also to support their activities, including the TDC activities in Taipei. And through our interaction with them, we understand some of the environment of the operation and some of the difficulties that they have met. In order to increase the understanding of Hong Kong, we organize certain seminars and exchange sessions, and our office in December of 2014 and in June of 2015 in Taipei and Tainan respectively organized seminars or fora concerning the Hong Kong and Taiwan financial and also other industrial cooperation. And also for the Yilan Prefecture, we have also organized a seminar to promote Hong Kong's advantages, and also with the Taipei City, we also had a trade and economic cooperation and development seminar. So we have been more macro, that is, apart from focusing on Taiwan and Hong Kong, we had been more macro talking about the region. And also, we have been encouraging Taiwanese companies to come to Hong Kong to use the services that we provide to develop the mainland market and overseas market through Hong Kong. And Invest Hong Kong had visited 279 companies and were able to clinch 13 deals. And also they visited the various areas and the industries to understand the operation environment of these industries and to promote Hong Kong. In terms of culture, we have been in close liaison with the cultural office, and we have been introducing to them the situation in Hong Kong. And also we have been working together with the financial journals, the Cosmo, New Youth, and other journals to promote the Hong Kong industry's logistics industry and also in other commercial sectors. Now, in terms of culture, through the cooperation of the two sides, we organize a Hong Kong Week. We say it is a Hong Kong Week, but it's actually month-long. There are exhibitions, performances, and seminars, and they are very well received by the Taiwanese. Looking forward in the future year, we will be stepping up with our relationship, forging close economic relationship between Hong Kong and Taiwan, support Hong Kong businesses in Taiwan, and also in November of this year in Taipei, we will be organizing again the Hong Kong Week. And in central Taiwan, we will have another exchange activity. Perhaps I should close my presentation here. Yes, Mr. Ma Feng Kwok, before you ask your question, I have a question for you. Can we extend this meeting by 15 minutes? Can we do that? Well, I have a very short question. Well, you may have a simple question, but I'm not sure about the next speaker. Do you agree? Yes, we are all in agreement. Very good. Extend 15 minutes. Ma Feng Kwok and then Lam Tai Fai. Well, first of all, we welcome back the officers from Taiwan. And I would affirm the work of the Taiwan office, and I'm in support of that. I'm looking at paragraph 16 there. Now, it says ETCO will actively encourage Taiwan companies to invest, and also there would be a framework for cooperation between Hong Kong and Taiwan for economic cooperation. I would like to know what is the attitude on the other side and what work have we done to this end, and what is a timetable leading to implementation? Will there be an agreement on that, in particular for cultural and creative industries? What impact will it have on these industries? Please, Mr. Yong. I will ask Mr. Chang to supplement. If I can just answer the question first, I'll try. Now, in terms of the Hong Kong-Taiwan economic cooperation, yes, we have in various fora made that public, and we are prepared to start discussions, but so far discussions have not actually begun yet. We will, through different channels, especially through the platform of the Cooperation Committee, that is a Hong Kong-Taiwan Cooperation Committee, to kickstart this line of negotiations, and also encourage more support from the industries and the economic sector, both in Taiwan and Hong Kong, in furthering this end. And we will also take on board some of the opinions expressed today. Mr. Wong, well, I do not have a lot to supplement. Mr. Yong had already answered the question, and it is true that they are at present not exactly interested in pursuing just yet the economic framework. Mr. Chair, Taiwan is a place familiar to Hong Kong people. Now, I've been there 2-3 times this year, and even just over the summer. Yes, I have certain sentimental ties to Taiwan, and there are a number of industries that we can develop. Tourism, cultural industries are possibilities. But on the other hand, it is highly attritional, the political turmoil within Taiwan and the very frequent election exercises. All these are detrimental to the economic development of Taiwan, and I worry that the Taiwanese relationship vis-a-vis China is affected by these election activities, as we have seen very recently in the last round, or the present round of elections. And these outcomes affect the relationship on the two sides of the straits, and this in turn would affect the economic relationships. Now, I would like to learn from you, from your vantage point in Taiwan. You would have a lot of information. I would like to know what you think would be the impact on trade and economics given the results of the outcome of the elections. For EDFA, will it contract? And what about goods and talents exchange between the two lands? Would these be affected? Thank you very much, Mr. Lam, for the question. For the Taiwan political reality and the elections, I don't think it is right for me to comment on those here. But Mr. Lam is accurate in saying that the outcome of the political activities and the elections would affect the economic development, etc. We are closely monitoring the situation and to see how the outcome would affect the relationship, especially for trade and economics between Hong Kong and Taiwan. This is early days yet. January 16th is election day, and after that, which party will come into power and what kind of policy would be promulgated, especially for policies concerning the to both sides of the straits. This is early yet. Well, this is certainly not early. We have to be prepared both ways. Of course, I respect your view. Now, for IVS, and some people say that this is all very good for Hong Kong. Some people say that it affects Hong Kong's livelihood in a number of ways. What is a Taiwanese view of this? Of mainland tourists, since we have made the policy more stringent, restrictive, I know that some of the mainland tourists have gone to Taiwan. Taiwan seems to have turned out the beneficiary in this.
I'm going to say a few words, and then Mr. Rex Cheng will report to you the actual situation on the ground. As far as my understanding is concerned, as for individual visit scheme for mainlanders visiting Taiwan, 4 years ago it was started to be implemented. Mainland visitors can visit Taiwan based on where this on the cities. The quota in September, as at the end of September, was 5,000 per day. That's the present arrangement. As for the actual situation, Mr. Cheng will report to you. Mr. Cheng, please.
Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Lam, for the question. My understanding in Taiwan is this. In recent months, mainland visitors going to Taiwan have declined. It was reported that many have gone to Japan. Because of time constraint, we cannot continue our meeting. Item 5. Chairman, haven't you extended the meeting by a quarter of the hour?
I try my best because I have to make an arrangement for another matter. Time doesn't allow me. Together with the vice chairman and the SCED, I will meet the SCED to discuss the agenda of the panel in the coming half year. Please, before the 26th of October, write to the secretary. All right, meeting adjourned.